What's going on, guys, and welcome back to LOI TV. Today we are joined by a very special guest. It's only Robbie Lyle from Arsenal Fan TV. Robbie, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate it.
Good.
How are you keeping? Busy day yesterday, transfer deadline day. Big deal going through late in the day.
Yeah, no, it was a very busy day. And of course, Arsenal, which is very unusual for us, we pulled off like the biggest deal of the day.
Yeah.
And getting Thomas Partey. And yeah, it was very good. We've needed a signing like Thomas Partey for a very long time, you know what I mean? And I think like sort of universally amongst all Arsenal fans, it was really well received. Great signing, absolutely brilliant. And we had a good transfer window. So which is not always something I can say for Arsenal over the years. So no, it was very, very good.
No, I'm an Arsenal fan as well myself. Like, and
okay.
It's years really. I think it's the first big signing since Aubameyang that we kind of needed. You know, be crying out for the midfielder for years now. But yeah, obviously, I mean, with Partey coming in, obviously a huge loss as well, going to Source leaving. So, any opinions on that?
Yeah, no, excuse me. Yes, that was sad because I know the guy who does the Gunnosaurus, and I think the thing is about it is that where everybody's missing the point here is that actually he's worked at Arsenal for years and years and years doing many other things. Gunnosaurus, I think, was just like a little side thing he did, but he was actually an employee at Arsenal. So he's lost his wider job, and I think that's more where it's a bit sad, you know, because I think the Gunnosaurus thing was almost like a voluntary, you know, something he kind of volunteered to do ended up doing over the years. But he's been employed at Arsenal doing many other things over the years behind the scenes. So the fact that he's been let go, that's sad. It's the reality at the moment, though, unfortunately. You know what I mean? A lot of people losing their jobs up and down the country because of the pandemic. But yeah, no, I feel it for him, Jerry. He's a nice guy.
Yeah,
you know, and hopefully get back soon when the fans start coming back into the stadium and stuff. Hopefully, I mean,
yeah,
it won't be the same without him, really.
Yeah, well, I think some of the stories have been very exaggerated that, you know, there's going to be no more Gunnosaurus. And I think there was a lot of mischief making by the newspapers, dropping it on transfer deadline day. And it's just a typical, you know, I felt that, you know, it was a bit ridiculous, the whole thing. I'm more focused on the guy who's lost his job, right? It's not just the Gunnosaurus thing will continue on. I mean, even if they could put anybody inside that.
Put Ozil inside it.
They have been suggested to put Ozil in there. But the guy's lost his job at the club. And that's the wider issue. And, you know, I just felt that the newspapers and that, it was just a bit of, for them, it's a bit of fun. A guy's lost his job. And a guy that's been loyal to Arsenal for a long, long time. And that's the bigger issue for me.
Yeah,
absolutely. Of course, we did get you on today to talk about last week's news. Obviously, the Europa League draw put Arsenal in the same group as Dundalk, the champions of Ireland at the moment. Not for long, obviously, though. They are currently sixth in the league over here. And that's out of 10 teams as well. So it's actually the bottom half of the table. But they do have a few games in hand, so they still could finish around the top three area. But it hasn't been a fantastic season for Dundalk. What was your initial reaction to the group that you saw?
Obviously it's quite a good group because, you know, we have to be real. We're supposed to beat the teams that are in there, Dundalk, Rapid Vienna, Molde. We're supposed to beat those teams. So for us, I was pleased with the group. But then on the other hand, absolutely gutted that, you know, I would have loved to have come to Dundalk. You know what I mean? That would have been, I've never been there before. It would have been absolutely brilliant to go, you know, it'd be a short trip. I'm sure Arsenal would have brought absolutely thousands of fans to there. And obviously there's thousands of Irish fans as well. So I'm so gutted that we can't get to go. You know, I mean, that's the thing that's really, you know, every time that we're in the Europa League, one of the things about the Europa League is that you do get drawn against teams that you've never, ever played before. So we've had games like, I remember we played a couple of years ago, we played Östersunds over in Sweden. I've never even heard of them before.
Yeah.
But, you know, we went on a trip over there and it was a sort of like a ski resort. It was just so different to anywhere we'd ever been before.
Yeah.
You know, and I was really, you know, you always kind of look forward to the draw to say, is there going to be a team in there that where we haven't really been to that place before? Because you've been to your Bayerns, your Dortmunds and, various other teams many, many times. So when I saw that, I was like, ah, oh, what a great trip that would have been to Dundalk, get over there to Ireland. You know, I remember I was over in Ireland a couple of seasons ago when Arsenal did some pre-season friendlies in Dublin.
Yeah.
And it was brilliant. So it's, I think the fans really are the ones that are really going to miss out. The fans of Dundalk, obviously, it would have been great for them as well. Obviously Arsenal fans who would have loved to have travelled over there and would have came over in their thousands. So that I really am gutted for that, you know.
Yeah, because the game has been played in the Aviva as well. So
yeah, it's been played national in the Aviva, which is like it's the 50,000, like it's the national stadium. Because Oriel Park,
I went to the Aviva because when we went over there for the friendly, we played Chelsea. That's where we played in the
Aviva. I remember that.
It's where you play the rugby, right? And so it's a lovely stadium and I remember it well, and you know, we played Chelsea in there. It was a packed house.
It's literally like it's really big deal. It was a big deal for our Irish fans as well, because what you got to keep in mind is this is the first time, it's only 3 times in 9 years that an Irish team has qualified for Europa League. So it's, you know, it doesn't come around often. I remember a few seasons ago, Shamrock Rovers got drawn in Tottenham's, group, and they went 1-0 up against Shamrock Rovers. Yeah, we don't talk about them. the white chai. But they went 1-0 up at White Hart Lane, and like the scenes like were unbelievable. Crazy. So, I mean, obviously, I'm an Arsenal.
I would have been jumping for Shamrock Rovers.
definitely anyone else but Spurs, like. But it's a bit of a shame, because obviously as an Arsenal fan, like, you know.
Who won in the end?
Oh, like Tottenham, I think, won.
3-1, I think, in the end. 3-1, I think.
It was a giant killing.
For the 5 minutes that Rovers are up, like. You'd like to see Dundalk get, just, I mean, from a neutral point of view, as a League of Ireland fan, I do kind of like, I mean, Arsenal, I mean, we're going to get through the group. I mean, if we don't, it would be an absolute disaster. So if Dundalk could pick up like a point or something, like, it would be unbelievable. Ooh. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I'm trying to stay neutral here now. I'm on a League of Ireland fan.
I'm sorry. As much as I love the Irish, right? But I can't be giving away even a point. Sorry.
It's not a charity.
I'd love a good game. But no, as I said, I feel gutted for the fans of Dundalk. Imagine how buzzing they would have been for that game. Yeah. And like you said, if it had been the Aviva Star, I didn't even realise it was going to be at the Aviva. So that would have made it even better, because that means you would have had loads and loads of Dundalk fans, loads of neutral fans as well, like you said, people are just interested in. And also you'd have had loads of Arsenal fans, because they would have, Arsenal fans would have travelled in their droves. As soon as an Arsenal fan hears Ireland, they're like,
my family are all Arsenal.
We're talking about them sort of things at the actual game, you know what I mean? So, I know with what doing AFTV that we have massive support in Ireland, massive. Yeah. And I mean, every Arsenal game I go to, when, you know, before this pandemic, you meet so many fans who've actually travelled over for the day for Ireland. It's lots. Yeah. So.
Yeah.
It's a real shame, really, really. When that came out of the house, I was like, oh, why this year?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
All years.
Yeah. Even like my younger brother, like my family would all be Arsenal. And the first thing my brother said, he was like, is there any way you can swing a few tickets for the game through the channel? I was like, yeah, I'll try, but no guarantees.
Yeah, it would have been the hottest ticket, and it's a real shame. It's a real shame.
Yeah, definitely.
Nothing we can do at the moment, is there? I mean, it is what it is.
That's it. I think for one of the games, I believe Arsenal are playing Man United 2 days after it. So, I mean, we're not going to see the first team playing realistically for Arsenal either, the fixtures. What kind of team do you think they're going to put out, would you imagine?
Yeah, you know, the thing is, right, I was going through the squad this morning now that with all the players we've brought in and the players that have left. And the squad will be strong. It'll be strong, even if we've got Man United a couple of days after. And yes, it will be a much changed team. But a lot of those players that will come in are still players that have played regularly in the first team. So if it's even, it's like the other day when we played against Liverpool. That was a much changed team in the Carabao Cup. But even the youngsters in that team are very experienced. I mean, Saka, he's an England international now, you know. Yeah. You've got Reece Nelson, you've got guys like Smith Rowe. Then, of course, you've got guys still left at the club like Socrates, Mustafis, Mohamed El-Neny, Xhaka's could play in that game. Yeah, I mean, it could be anybody. You know, Eddie Nketiah, who's been banging in the goals. So it's not like I'll say under Arsene Wenger, a lot of times he played kids that you weren't really familiar with. These ones they play a lot of first team football. So even with a much changed Arsenal team, it will still be a strong team. I mean, Pepe started against Liverpool in the Carabao Cup, you know? Yeah. And if it's not Pepe starting, they might make Willian start if they're keeping back Pepe for the weekend. So there's a lot of strength in depth now in so many areas. You know, at the back, you could get a William Saliba come in. You could have a Rob Holding at the back. You know, you can have Kolasinac. You know, all these guys, they're, you know, like Kolasinac, international players who play regular first-team football. I think probably the only possible very inexperienced player who'd be in that team might be the new goalkeeper we brought in called Renison. Maybe he might get a run out in that game. But apart from that, I think it will still be a very strong team. And Mikel Arteta as well, he's not one of the top of managers that just plays very, very weak teams and doesn't have any insurance on the bench. He's the sort of guy that would still have a Lacazette and, you know, a couple of those big guns in wait, in just in case things ain't going right, he can fling them on.
Yeah.
So I'd expect to see, even though we got Man United a few days afterwards, I'd expect to see quite a strong Arsenal team. I mean, the way Man United have been going recently, we could put out, maybe we should play the weaker team against them. Obviously that'll be a massive game. United have got out now and spent money and stuff like that. That'll be a huge game. So yeah, we would be a much changed team, but I still expect it to be strong. That'll be a strong team.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. On a side note, before you got the or heard about the draw or anything, have you ever heard of much Irish domestic football? Have you ever have you heard of Dundalk before? Like, is there anything that you'd know about them? Like,
I obviously know Dundalk, I know Shamrock Rovers, you know, some of the I don't really follow it. I think the last Irish football game I watched was it earlier this year? I don't know. They were showing it because sometimes they show it on BT Sport.
Yeah, it probably was Bows versus Bohemians versus Shamrock Rovers is the big one.
Yeah, Bohemians and another
Dublin,
team.
So, yeah, it's the Dublin derby. Yeah. So
I've watched games. I've watched some games when they showed it on BT Sport, but I'd be lying if I say I'm aware of the bigger teams there in Ireland. Yeah. But I'd be lying if I say I've really watched a lot of it, just because really I watch so much football, but they don't just show enough of it over here. They tend to maybe if there's an international break on, maybe they might feature an Irish game. So I'm really not familiar.
Yeah, fair. Just to give you a bit of background before we played Dundalk, should be saying from a neutral perspective here. But so the new manager who came in charge is Filippo Giovagnoli. And he only got appointed a few weeks ago. There was a fella called Vinnie Pert who was in charge before that, who got sacked after he had a pretty poor start to the league. So this fella who got hired is an Italian guy. He used to coach at AC Milan under 18s, but his biggest previous experience before he got the Dundalk job was he literally ran summer camps in New York. So when he got appointed, everyone was like, who is this guy? Like, and he literally called himself, there was leak that he called it a kamikaze mission because he knew like the fans were really on his back. You know, real kind of like unrest amongst Dundalk. Like, and to be fair to him, like he's done like a unreal job since he came in, really. Like, they beat an Andorran team. They went through the Europa League qualifiers. They beat an Andorran team and then they beat another team on penalties.
Yeah, Sheriff from Moldova.
But they've had like a really, really good start. The last team they beat, was it KI from Faroe Islands? They beat them 3-1 in the Aviva. And just for perspective, like the Europa League, like qualifying for Europe is like, for an Irish team, it's everything because the domestic league is like so underfunded here. Like, the winner only gets like 100 grand, where in Europe, if you qualify for Europe, like, Dundalk already have 3 million in the bank, and they'll have, like, for every point that they get in the Europa League. And, like, I mean, the draw that they have is pretty favourable. Apart from Arsenal, it's pretty favourable. Like, could definitely grab a few points there. So, I mean, it's massive, like.
And that's why it's a shame that there's no fans there, because, you know, with the fans, it brings more profile on Dundalk as well. I mean, they'll get a lot of profile anyway.
Yeah.
Sorry, the sun just keeps blazing out in my face. But they'll get a lot of profile from the game. But imagine if fans would have been there as well. It would have been so much more profile for the club as well. But it's fantastic. Yeah, I know. Obviously, teams like Dundalk, they've had to go through so many qualifying rounds and stuff like that to get to this stage. So it's a massive achievement for them, and I'm glad that they've got a draw like Arsenal. You know, it must be fantastic for them. I've just figured to myself, if we ever drop points to a manager that was running summer camps, I'm just trying to think of BG and Troops and those guys.
Oh, God, like, that was, we got
a boy on the we cannot afford to drop any point. That thing about a point, no, we can't. Dropping points to somebody run a summer camp. That would be it.
Yeah, underage summer camps in New York, like. So.
Oh, I'm kind of glad he has proven people wrong, though, in a way, because he has been a breath of fresh air since he's come in. Really, he's really up, like, been a Dundalk have really had a real upturn in form since he's come in, and the draw in the Europa League was favourable, realistically. Like, Shamrock Rovers, in comparison, got AC Milan in the qualifying round, only lost 2-0, but you're never really going to get through. Ibrahimovic was starting the game and stuff like that. It's always going to be very difficult. But, they had a nice draw for the Europa League, but still a huge achievement to get to the group stage.
Massive achievement. And, on appointing managers, this is a bit like with our manager at the moment, Mikel Arteta. You know, I mean, when he was appointed, you know, even me, I had doubts. I'm like, is he going to be able to take on such a big job?
Yeah,
and it was, you know, there was the jokes out there that, you know, he put out cones for Guardiola and stuff like that, you know, and how's he going to do? And he's coming and he's proving himself. And sometimes sometimes you need to think out of the box when it comes to managers, you know, and when it comes to players as well, you know, give them a chance. I mean, our greatest ever manager, Arsene Wenger, you know, I remember when he first came in, you know, I mean, newspapers taking the mick out of it, even fans. I remember quite clearly Arsenal fans upset, saying, how can we get this guy from Japanese football? That's where he was managing before. It's ridiculous. Mm-hmm. So sometimes you've got to give, you know, you've got to give people a chance. Not every manager was an ex-player or an ex, you know what I mean? And even sometimes a lot of those ex-players, and, you know, they were captains and things like that, they don't necessarily make good managers.
Yeah,
you know, the role of a manager has really evolved. So you've got to give people a chance in life. And, you know, if he's coming in, he's doing great things, you know, that's good. That's great for him.
Yeah. And he was asked the manager was asked what his favourite draw would be for the group stage. He did say Tottenham because it was a dream to come up against Jose Mourinho. So, you got close.
You could have got Tottenham in the qualifying because they had to go through the qualifiers. And I'll tell you what, they had a few hairy moments in qualifiers as well. So,
definitely.
But he's got a bigger test on his hands now.
Coming up against a real team now.
Real proper team. He's got to get a proper team with proper support, man. Not no.
Just away from the football, just for a second, Robbie. If we, like, obviously we're a kind of a small enough channel. We've been doing it for, I think it's like 2 years. It's mostly Ross, to be fair. It's mostly his baby. Like, but I mean, as a small enough channel, like, we were kind of, I mean, no two ways about it. Like, we were definitely inspired by you, and like the especially like a few seasons ago, like when you really popped off, there was a few viral videos and stuff. And it was definitely Ross came up and he was like, just imagine if we did this, the League of Ireland. Like, so we were just wondering, like, obviously we kind of got inspiration from you. Where did you get your inspiration? Where did the idea come from? Like, because you were really like the pioneer, the first one to kind of do it. I know you see so many of these kind of fan channels around, like, so
I was kind of got a bit of inspiration and idea from a friend of mine who's doing a boxing channel called Coogan Cassius, and he had a boxing channel at that time. It's called iFilm London. It's now called IFL TV.
Yeah,
I've heard of it. Yeah,
me and him are good friends. and he's a big Arsenal fan as well. We used to go to games together, and I was like, you know, Coogan, why don't you do it? We could do this for football. But obviously, he was busy doing his channel, and I just had the idea that, you know, wouldn't it be amazing to interview fans, because you just never heard from fans. You know what I mean? You hear from all these so-called experts. And sometimes, for me, the experts are poor. I heard an expert yesterday on TV. I'm not going to name who it was. Asked the question about, what do you think of James Rodriguez at Everton? And he started talking about how, yeah, it would be a great signing for Everton, when James Rodriguez has been playing for him for about 3-4 weeks. So that, when I hear things like that, and that's an expert, an ex-footballer on TV talking, that when I hear things like that, it makes me realise the importance of fans. The fans are the ones that go there week in, week out. They invest not just their money, but all their emotions in their football team. So I used to be like, why? We never hear anything from the fans. Even when fans are on something, I used to see fans, they'd be on a programme. Like, for instance, they used to do programmes where they do the draw for the FA Cup and that, and they'll have a load of fans in the background with their kits on. And then the ex-players at the front doing the draw, and they're just in the back. They're just literally there for optics, you know what I mean? And I'm like, no, this is wrong. So I'm like, I want to do something where we can hear from the fans. And that was just basically why I started it. It was just like to give fans a chance to have their say on camera. And it's just grown and grown since then. And I'm really pleased when I see that, you know, it's inspired other people of other clubs. Get a lot of people coming to me and say, you know, we're doing this because we saw your thing and thought we could do this for our club. And I'm like, I always love to see that, and always willing to try and help people to give them tips and that, and how to improve and how to build it. Because we've kind of, you know, we kind of done all that. We've had all the knockbacks, we've had all the bumps along the roads, but it's been good. It's good, because sometimes it's good to learn that way. You learn from your mistakes along the way. It's good. So, and you can then pass it on to other people and say, yeah, you know, avoid doing that because this will happen. And, you know, so, but no, it's nice to know. That's really nice to know that you guys, you know, that we helped to inspire that. So, fantastic. Absolutely. Great.
Yeah. And in terms of touch back on the game, we do really appreciate your time. I know probably busy after the deadline day yesterday, but just touch back on the game again quickly. Just talking about Dundalk, obviously they're probably set up probably like very defensively, maybe a 5 at the back. They've played like that in Europe previously. They have a big enough team, like a lot of players are above 6 foot. So I suppose free kicks and corners could potentially be what they'll be living for, really, in terms of opportunities. And they did score a goal in their last Europa League game on the counter-attack, like it's a real good swift counter-attacking move. So those are the kind of things that Dundalk will be kind of like living for. And really doing in the game against Arsenal. Arsenal will obviously most of possession and stuff like that. So if you want to kind of touch on how Arsenal will approach the game with Dundalk, could perfect taking it seriously, maybe be a small issue among the camp?
I don't think under Mikel Arteta, what I've seen since he's taken over is that every game he expects players to take it very seriously, very professionally.
Yeah,
I think that's one thing he's really taken from Guardiola. He doesn't really go into games, and I used to get the impression sometimes under Arsene Wenger that we go and play certain teams and he's like, you know, just go out there, just play your game light work.
Which
a lot of teams, I suppose it was light work because of, you know, you get there in the end because you've got the better players, right? But I think Arteta's a little bit different to that. He's like, go out there, take it serious. That's play them like how you play Man United. I want to see you play. I still want to see these patterns of play. I still want to see closing down. I still want to see. So expect Arsenal to do what they've been doing under Arteta, which is play out from the back, build up play, very fast counter-attacking play, and a lot tougher than we've been in recent times. You know what I mean? These teams are a bit more steelier than we used to be. You know what I mean? I think maybe back in the day, maybe a team like Dundalk might have been able to physically maybe look to maybe rough Arsenal up. I think with this current Arsenal team, they don't really get roughed up no more. You know, and they've got some, you know what I mean, they've got some very physical players in there. And as I said, they're very driven to win. So I'd expect Arsenal to come all guns blazing. They're gonna come for it. They're not gonna, It's not going to be, you're not going to see a team coming on any sort of sympathy missions because, you know, they're playing a team in the Irish League. It's go out there, get the job done professionally, try and score goals, try and score as many goals as possible. And so, I don't think it's going to be a light touch Arsenal that Dundalk will come up against. I think that, from what I've seen of Mikel Arteta's teams, he's very driven to win.
Robbie, thanks so much for joining us today. Really appreciate your time.
Yeah, thank you very much.
I don't think we need to shout out your channel. I presume everyone's seen it already. But I'll leave a link in the description anyway.
Everyone go follow the channel. May have heard of it before.
All good. But listen, shame that we can't be there. Maybe you never know. It's just so horrible at the moment. You know what I mean? As I said, you know, even all three teams. Dundalk, Mold, I haven't been there before. I've never been to Rapid Vienna.
They're all fantastic trips, Great trips.
And it would have been great trips for the Dundalk fans as well, obviously, all of those places. So, but what can we do at the moment? Hopefully, by we get into next year, maybe we can start seeing fans come back and some sort of resolution to this
To be honest, as an Arsenal fan, I mean, I am a bit sick of doing Europa League nights at this stage. So
I'm tired of the Europa League as well. Good steps in some of the signings we've made. It's going to be tough. Every team in the Premier League is strengthened. There's so many good teams at the moment. Good. Leicester are looking good. You know, Everton are looking good. Wolves. You know, so it's not even just your traditional top, say, six teams. There's a lot of other teams now knocking on the door that are very
Aston Villa, potentially.
Aston Villa have done, they've done very well in their signings. You know what I mean? Yeah. Look what they've done to Liverpool. You know what I mean? So it's going to be a tough season. And I do think that playing behind closed doors is having certain effects on some teams. It's better for some teams and worse for others. So, but hopefully we can get back into the Champions League. Maybe Dundalk in the Champions League.
You never know.
You can dream.
Thanks so much, Robbie. Thanks, Robbie. Really appreciate your time.
Legends.
Cheers.
Thanks very much. Cheers.
Oh my God.